You may be seated. It's fitting that a guy named Jim would want an artist named Jim to sing at his funeral. So, we want to thank you on behalf of Elizabeth and the entire Moore family for your presence today. There's so much power in just being without saying a word. Just being here says something. It means you love them and that you walk with them in their grief and that you'll walk with them in the days forward. So we're glad that you took some time out this beautiful Saturday morning to be here to honor Jim and to comfort the family. You know, there's just a few of us that are around in the hill country now that I say escaped from behind the pine curtain in East Texas, and Jim was one of those guys. Jim was born May the 2nd, 1935, to Roy and Ethel Moore in Mineola, Texas. Went to a two-room country school and then to middle school and high school in Van, Texas. Jim played all sports available and was especially talented in tennis. He received a scholarship in tennis to East Texas College and Commerce. For you Aggie people, now that's Texas A&M Commerce. There you go. One day when he was a senior, he was sitting in a swing on the porch of a woman's dorm, figure that, watching the girls go by. And he said to a friend, as this one lady walked by, "I'm going to marry that girl." And then Jim and Elizabeth Ann Spiegel were married March 15th, 1959, and were married for 63 years. Jim was drafted into the Army for 3 years, and after being discharged from the Army, he taught high school English, speech, and debate, and was the debate team coach. His debate team won many trophies. He loved teaching the students and the debate team. He taught for 30 years in the Brazosport Independent School District. He and Elizabeth lived in Lake Jackson for 40 years. Have one son, Stephen, and two grandsons, Kobe and Jacob, and one great-granddaughter, Gwendolyn, and he loved being with them. Jim and Elizabeth retired and moved to Meadow Lakes, and Jim enjoyed golf and fishing, certainly serving here at the church, and the ministry that he really loved was the food pantry And they, for 20 years, he took care of that. There will be a burial following the service at Lakeland Hills Memorial on Park Road 4. I will remind you that there is not going to be an escort, so we will just gather out there, so be careful. Family had selected Psalm 46 as a scripture this morning. Psalmist writes these words, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change and the mountains shake and the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. And God is in the midst of the city, and it shall not be moved. And God will help it when morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar and the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice and the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us, and the God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on earth. He makes war cease to the end of the earth, and he breaks the bow and shatters the spear, and he burns the shield with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in all the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge." Let's pray. Father God, you are the God of all comfort. We ask that you fill this family with comfort. You are the God of peace. We ask, Father, for your peace to be present today. And you are the God of love. We pray, Father, that Elizabeth and her family understand and comprehend and experience your love in powerful ways today through this memorial service, through other family members, through friends, through words of encouragement. But especially, Father, we pray that your spirit fill them with the spirit of love. We're grateful, Father, for your son Jesus, who is our foundation, who is our life, and who is our hope. May he be exalted today as we remember such a good life that was lived from one of your servants who was faithful unto death. We pray this through Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing some today, so get your voices ready. Chris, amen, is going to lead us.
Let's all sing. I'm satisfied with just a cot below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the rents will shine, I want a gold one, that silver lined. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land. Are lonely, I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a robe and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop in that bright land where someday yonder we'll nevermore wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold.
Relationship, a powerful word that has meaning and purpose for our lives. As Christians, we know and accept that the most necessary relationship is that of a connection with Jesus Christ. We understand the meaning and the purpose of that relationship is to become more like Christ, to grasp his goodness, faithfulness, meekness, and the many other positive attributes that are so important, and thus be able to be, to have a sincere, honest relationship. In Scripture, we see that Jesus was asked for the most important commandment, and he addressed loving God completely, which of course requires relationship. Jesus went on to say, second was like it, in that he instructs us to love others, which again requires relationship. My purpose for addressing Jesus' instructions is to point to the second command as it relates to my dear sweet Uncle Jimmy. I'm confident that each of us has multiple stories we could share of how we've been impacted by Jim's presence in our personal journey of life. Jim Moore was easy to love and even easier to admire. I give God credit for shaping his good character, but genuinely I believe the Lord used Aunt Elizabeth to hold the hammer and chisel to chip away the rough spots. Since I was about five, I've been blessed with so many occasions to be with the two of them and just observe. I especially remember Jim must have been a horrible, untruthful person. I didn't want to call him a liar. In those late 1950s, because otherwise he could have never captured the heart of such a beauty as Aunt Elizabeth. Yep, even at 5 years old, I knew she was too good looking for him to snag. Later it became obvious her inner beauty should have also made her out of reach. As the years went by, Jim caught up, no doubt with her aid. In all seriousness, Jim was a very special man. I loved being around him, and a visit never passed without learning something new. Yes, he was a powerful teacher and debate instructor, if you knew him well and remember such. In one such visit, he taught me something that has forever changed my life trajectory. While I question if I should share the story today, I can't resist. One bright, glorious, sunny day, Uncle Jim decided to address with me toilet etiquette. He asked me, "Why do you bother putting the lid down?" I gave him what I thought was an acceptable debate coach-inspired answer, to which he instantly responded, "That's a waste of time, and it slows down your next visit." Well, I've not placed the lid down for 20 years since. I could easily fill a small book, if I had a better memory, of all his advice. And you know, I don't have it written here, but I'm gonna inject a story as well, even on the last visit there at the nursing home. All Jim wanted to talk about was, "I wanna go home, I wanna go home, I want to go home, you can take me home." And I decided to ask him, "Uncle Jim, share with me your favorite vacation you ever took." To which he responded, "I know what you're trying to do." Well, the man was indeed intelligent. He saw right through me. He is loaded with common sense, of which he was more than happy to share. So if you had any kind of meaningful relationship with this Christian man, you knew you were going to learn something new on every visit. You just could not help but anticipate his shared wisdom and knowledge with admiration, love, and respect. So today we honor him. Whether you're present in this building or watching on the live stream, the family wants you to know that we sincerely thank you for sharing this moment with us. In closing, I want to publicly address to Aunt Elizabeth. You have more than just my love. You have every ounce of my devotion and care for your remaining years, exactly as I promised Uncle Jim, of which there better be many, many, many years. If you would bow with me. Heavenly Father, we humbly ask for your Holy Spirit to both shower and fill us with tranquility and peace. May Elizabeth, Stephen, and the rest of the Moore family especially find comfort now and in the days ahead. We thank you for your amazing love and the promise of a home in heaven. We're grateful for the assurance that your faithfulness means Jim is now enjoying renewed sight, hearing, and a bodily strength that means he is probably golfing on the back nine at this very moment. Bless us each with long memories of his rich life, the life of Jimmy Moore, shared with so many. As we honor him today, may we honor you as the magnificent Father you are. It is in the sweet name of your Son that we pray, Jesus. Amen.
On a hill far away stood an old
and exchange.
my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
I didn't want this day to come, Elizabeth. I will say, since starting, that I am one of the sole survivors of the Marble Falls Church of Christ Auditorium Class Bermuda Triangle for Preachers, because right about where Phil is sitting, Jim Moore, or maybe where John and Becky are, Jim Moore sat there, Buster Rasko sat across from him, and Don Holt sat in front of them. And if I got to say about 10 minutes of a 35 or 40 minute class, it was a good week. Listen, that triangle would just eat preachers alive. They would go in and never come out. So I have a secret that I'm going to take to the grave, because the Bermuda Triangle is now all gone. But man, did they make class fun. So, well, there were several passages about teachers and teaching in the Bible. The first few chapters of Proverbs describe wisdom as the great teacher. And in those chapters, there are exhortations to listen to and to practice the instruction of teachers. There are also warnings, both explicit and implied, concerning the failure to listen to the voice of teaching and instruction. It's mostly this: if you don't listen to teachers, your life's going to be a grease fire. That's kind of Hebrewish. You know, Jesus recognized the importance of teachers, even at a young age. And Luke tells us of the time when Jesus was about 12 years old. He was in the temple, and he was listening to teachers and asking really important questions. And then Paul, in his writing to the churches both at Corinth and Ephesus, lists teaching and teachers as critical positions and tasks that are needed for the health and well-being of the community of faith. And teachers are so important and needed, but often so unappreciated. So today we remember and honor a teacher named Jim Moore. And I invite you to enter Jim's classroom one more time and review what he taught us. By the way, there will be a test at the end, so please pay attention. Here's lesson number one from our teacher, Jim. Life is to be enjoyed. Listen, to enjoy life, you should realize that life itself is a gift from God. It's not all fun, it's not all pleasant, but it can always bring joy. And Jim was fun. Even when he was being a little snarky, he was fun. His wit was clever, his smile infectious. And for Jim, what made life enjoyable was good food. Fried oysters, or Elizabeth's chicken fried steak, or Chick-fil-A nuggets, or creating a special delicacy of tomato basil soup and puffy Cheetos. Don't knock it till you try it. Or maybe what made life good was hot chocolate on the lake when the Christmas lights came on in Marble Falls. What makes life enjoyable is going to new places, in meeting new people, even people who can be just as snarky as Jim could be at times. Elizabeth told me on a trip to Ireland, they went to the Blarney Castle and they were staying at an Airbnb close to the castle. And the host told Jim, there's no need for you to kiss the Blarney Stone. You've got quite enough Blarney on your own. Of course, what makes life enjoyable is what Richard mentioned, and that's relationships with good people. So Jim listened to the master teacher Jesus, because Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it abundantly. It's lesson number one. Lesson number two, share your skills and talents with others. Jim was a tremendous athlete, as we mentioned, attending college on a tennis scholarship. In the early part of his teaching career, he did teach tennis. And I'm sure he taught his students about forehands and backhands and ground strokes and lobs and serves and drop shots. But I'm more sure that Jim taught them about life. And Jim's greatest skill, I think we'll all agree, was his ability to talk, which he did often and well. And he found great joy and satisfaction in teaching and coaching debate, as well as the other subject, English. He challenged his students to know this: know what you believe, know why you believe it, and articulate what you believe. And the students did win a lot of competitions, but more importantly, I think they took those principles that Jim taught them in order to win the game of life. Trophies get put up in the attic, life goes on. By the way, if you ever taught a Bible class with Jim in it, you experienced his great debate skills. He could play the devil's advocate better than anybody that I've ever met. And we danced a lot of dances in that aisle right there over the years. But I wonder how many of Jim's students are now teachers because Jim shared his life and his talent with them. And so Jim listened to Jesus, the master teacher. If I may paraphrase a parable, don't hide your talents. Lesson number three, children are really important. Jim not only taught children how to read and write and to speak in his 30-year career in public school system, he taught children outside the classroom. At this church, he taught our junior high Bible class for many years, including my daughter. I can blame a little bit of her, you know, she could debate too, Jim. Her mother and I might have a different word for that, but we'll call it that today. And Jim made Bible class for those junior high kids, which you know are hard to reach. He made it enjoyable, and I would say transportable, that they could take those lessons outside the walls of his church. Jim was an avid golfer. He had such a sweet swing. Have you ever played golf with him? It's like, you see that Fred Couples swing, like, did he really just hit the ball that far? That old guy just did that and barely swing? And I am thankful because both of my kids got to play golf with Jim. And my kids are 10 years apart in age. And Jim gave Mason some clubs when he was little. And Mason's got a really good swing, too. And I think Jim had something to do with that. For Jim, those golf lessons, though, weren't really about golf. You know what they were doing, what he was doing? He was telling my kids, you matter, and you're important to me. And he took time out to do that. And I'm sure those type of experiences that Jim created for my kids were repeated with his own kids and his grandkids and his great-grandkids and his students. Because one thing that I learned from Jim is children aren't the future, they are the now, and they matter now. So Jim listened to the master teacher Jesus, who said, bring the children to me, for they are the kingdom of heaven. So lesson number three. Lesson number four, marriage and family really matter. For 63 years, Jim and Elizabeth taught us what a wonderful and godly marriage is to look like. Again, not perfect, not without its trials, but man, did they love each other fiercely. Marriage is not without hard times and hard conversations and hard decisions, but marriage images for us the relationship between Jesus and his church. And marriage means sacrifice and giving up things, like giving up your car when your wife, your new bride, gets a job and driving in a scooter to the military base. Marriage also means sometimes when you ride that scooter with your wife, somebody's got to get off and push it because it didn't have enough power to get up a hill. I'm not sure who did the driving and who did the pushing. Knowing Jim, he talked Elizabeth into it. Elizabeth, Jim loves you, still does, as I mentioned, fiercely and faithfully. From the first day that he saw you, you know, today we would call that stalking, but I guess it was okay back then. The first day that he saw you outside that dorm room, until he took his last breath with you at his side, he absolutely adored you and worshiped the ground you walked on. Being a father was important to Jim, and Stephen got a full dose of Jim's wisdom. You can fill in the blanks what that means. Since Jim believed in discipline, both the instructive type and the punitive type. And discipline, though, is a way of saying I love you. Stephen, I'm glad that you were able to be here with your parents these last few months and to give back some of that love that you so graciously received over the years. And maybe give back a little of that discipline back to your dad, right? See, Jim listened to the master teacher, Jesus, when Jesus said, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. And fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord. Family really matters. That's lesson number four. Lesson number five. Jesus must matter most of all. Jim's life was hidden in Christ. His life centered around his trust in Jesus and in serving Jesus in every aspect of his life. As we mentioned, he taught Bible class here, and he taught adult classes in churches where it's been before. And while a good week for Jim included Monday, Wednesday, Friday golf, Tuesday, Thursday fishing, Saturday shopping and hanging out at the house, Sunday was the day. Sunday was the day because it was a good week, but what made it a great week was gathering together with God's people for fellowship and for worship and for encouragement. The community of Marble Falls will forever be indebted to Jim for his commitment to and enhancement of our food pantry ministry. When I first moved here in 2006, the food pantry was about this big, maybe. Maybe half this big, Elizabeth. And Jim, with his charming East Texas self, as people came and began to benefit from that, took that from a budget of about $1,000 to now we have a separate building and multiplied the number of people who have been impacted through that ministry. In addition to the food pantry, Jim laid the groundwork, I think, for an overall effective local benevolent ministry. He taught me that benevolence is not just about what you hand out or give away in aid. Benevolence is about giving your time in order to listen to people and get to know them and try to understand where they are in life. Our philosophy of benevolence now in our church is to spend time with people, let them know that they matter, and that someone is willing to meet them where they are, and to the best of our ability, meet their needs. But it's not about food, and it's not about gas, and it's not about utility bills. It's about the people that we get to see. And in our office staff, Jim taught us that. And we still practice that. And what Jim taught me was that being present with those in need is demonstrating the presence of Jesus to others. And I believe this, Jim desires what God desires, and that's for all people to know Jesus and to commit their life to him. See, Jim listened to the master teacher, Jesus, when Jesus said, I came to seek and save that which is lost. Well, you ready for the test? I probably could have just given a summary. And we'll summarize these five lessons that we learned from Jim and through his life. The lifetime teacher, by the way, you can't be a lifetime teacher if you're not a lifetime learner. And perhaps we should listen again to the words of the master teacher, which Richard has already shared with us today. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Thank you, Jim Moore, for being our teacher with your life.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tinted skies with heavenly hue and framed the worlds with his great mind. There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive. From dust or a long, long time ago, a God whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word. There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive. Is life from mortal mind. God holds the grim within his hand. Though men may search, they cannot find, for God alone does understand. There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we serve. Set men free and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive. In him we live and we survive. From dust
following the prayer, the funeral directors will come. They're going to remove the flag from the casket, open the casket up, and they will direct you if you want to come by and pay your respects. Again, remember the burial will take place at Lakeland Hills Cemetery on Park Road 4 once we are dismissed. To the Moore family, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the people of God say together, amen.